today we're going to be honoring my mother by talking about one of cinema's most badass mothers, Sarah Connor from Terminator 2 Judgment Day.
Good call.
I have some issues that John Connor also has with his mom, and we're going to examine why I'm broken.
Wow.
Come with me if you want to live.
Here we go.
It's going to be great.
Hello and welcome to Cinema Therapy. I'm Jonathan Decker, licensed therapist. I love movies.
I am Alan Seawright, professional filmmaker, and I need therapy.
Stop it. Get some help.
So, Alan, what is the movie that changed you? I believe it actually ties into Mother's Day as well, doesn't it?
It does tie into Mother's Day. Today we're going to be honoring my mother by talking about one of cinema's most badass mothers, Sarah Connor from Terminator 2 Judgment Day.
Good call. She is badass.
She is super badass.
You broke my arm.
There are 215 bones in the human body. That's one.
My mother is a total badass, and I have some issues that John Connor also has with his mom. So we're going to, it's the whole thing. We're going to honor, and we're going to examine why I'm broken.
Wow. Here we go.
It's going to be great.
Who'd you learn this stuff from anyway?
From my mom. My real mom, I mean. Withdraw 300 bucks. Come on, baby.
This is
yes.
Young John Connor stealing money. Right. Learned how to do this.
Easy money.
From his
Come
survivalist
on.
Mom, who is raising him to be the savior of humanity.
Against an army of killer robots that is going to be coming.
That her?
Yes.
So she's pretty cool, huh?
No, she's a complete psycho. That's why she's up at Pescadero. It's a mental institute, okay? She tried to blow up the computer factory, but she got shot and arrested. Oh, she's a total loser. Come on, let's go spend some money.
So
there's a lot about this movie that is timeless. That mullet is not one of the
that
things.
That mullet does not hold up at all.
Folks, if you're enjoying this video, there's a lot more meaty discussion and geeking out in our extended director's cut on our membership site, as well as relationship courses that I have created for you, for your conflict resolution, communication, all of your relationships. Check it out.
The thing that I really identify with in that scene is just this childish understanding, and I went through a long period of really hating my mom.
Yeah.
Because I didn't understand why she was the way that she was. And the thing that I gotta say about my mom is she was actually a wonderful mother. The way she shows affection is criticism.
So there's different personality types, and there's like 1,000 different personality quizzes online, but yeah. One that we like to use that we have on our online relationship courses on our membership site, there's personality course on there, and we break it down into thinkers, dreamers, healers, and closers.
Right.
And I won't go into all of that right now, but thinkers are very analytical, they're very rational, there needs to be a plan, it needs to be airtight so that success is assured.
I find your arguments strewn with gaping defects in logic.
And my wife is a thinker, but she's very self-aware, and she says, thinkers show love by evaluation. The problem is that nobody else receives love by evaluation.
Nobody. Nobody does. So
when your mom was critical, she was trying to help you be better.
Absolutely.
Like Sarah Connor, trying to prepare John for what's coming, like prepare him for the harsh realities of his life and mission. And so I, from what I know about your mom, I'm sure that's what she was doing.
It absolutely is.
But to your kid, you're like, ouch.
All you know how to create is death and destruction.
Mom! We need to be a little more constructive here, okay?
But there are differences between how she showed love and how you would receive love.
And how I would receive love.
Love languages concept, right?
Yes. And because of that, I grew up feeling unloved and unworthy.
So here's Sarah Connor, and her whole thing, she starts in the first film, she's a waitress. She's not particularly badass at that point. She's a good person.
Sure.
But she's just living her life, and this killing machine is sent back in time to take her out because her son in the future is going to be the leader of the human resistance against the machines. But that experience is so terrifying. I mean, she definitely has PTSD and has shifted her entire worldview, because PTSD occurs when you think your world is safe and then you discover that it isn't. And it forever changes you. She shifts into a gear of survivalism that she never gets out of.
No.
And she's always on high alert. And so how she raises John is not loving, is not nurturing, it's, I've seen what these things are. I've seen what they can do. You need to be prepared. So you need to be tough. And so she doesn't show him a lot of tenderness, affection, support. She's basically really, really tough on him. Teaches him how to shoot, teaches him how to survive, teaches him how to steal money. And then her claims that killer robots from the future are coming, gets her landed in a mental institution. And like you're saying, he's got a child's understanding. He's like, my mom's a total psycho.
Yeah, she's just crazy. There's nothing good there. It's all just...
Right.
She made it up. It's crazy.
See.
I love this movie.
Spent a lot of time in Nicaragua and places like that. For a while there, she was with this crazy ex-Green Beret guy.
So, future John Connor has reprogrammed a Arnold Schwarzenegger model Terminator and sent it back to protect him.
So she could teach me how to be this great military leader. Then she gets busted. It's like, sorry, kid, your mom's a psycho, didn't you know?
He's having a huge paradigm shift right now.
It's like everything I've been brought to believe was all made of bull. I hated her for that. But everything she said was true. She knew. And nobody believed her. Not even me.
I thought he actually did a pretty good job in that scene of, you know, talking through. And this is how I process emotion, by the way. You can tell, because I started an internet show where I talk through my emotions. I have to talk. I think with my mouth open. You know, he grew up one way and then had a huge paradigm shift when he was told, no, your mother's crazy. None of that's real.
And he hated her for that.
And he hated her, which is totally understandable. Because, like, you're my mom. You're supposed to be a mom, right? You're supposed to just take care of me and love me and help me be a normal kid, and you taught me I was this weird future leader guy and I have to be the military commander of whatever. And then he's having this new paradigm shift of, oh no, it's all real, you're a Terminator.
You're really real.
Yes, Cyberdyne Systems Model 101.
In this scenario, to Sarah Connor's credit, as a pretty young kid, he's capable of processing that, having that paradigm shift and doing that because she has raised him to be a flexible battlefield commander who can adjust to situations.
We often assign a meaning to a person's behavior. You hurt me, therefore, this was your intention for doing it. This was why you did it.
Right.
I mean, that's something I do a lot of in therapy, is reminding people not...
Is hurting people?
No.
Oh.
Stop it or I'll bury you alive in a box!
That too, but it's for their good.
Oh.
Stuff's got to be opened up.
You mock my pain!
I don't hurt them. I bring the hurt to the surface and then we work on it. No, but is reminding people not to prescribe intentions.
Yeah.
Because so many people say, here's why he does this. Here's what he's thinking. And I'm saying, hang on, but you don't actually know that.
Do you know that he's doing it for that reason?
Yeah, you're seeing a behavior, you're prescribing an intent. Or my wife does things this way. And well, you don't know exactly what she's thinking. And John, he is having this shift where he says, okay, this behavior was hurtful, but I'm seeing it in this new light of she actually loves the hell out of me and wants me not to die.
Yeah.
And wants me to save the world. That's a big deal. Now, that specific story isn't relatable. Like, the most of us aren't going to grow up to be saviors of humanity. But having a parent...
pursued by robotic murderers.
But having a parent who does the best they can and ends up screwing up pretty royally...
That's the most relatable story on Earth.
Right?
We all have that. So they've rescued his mom. Finally,
he thinks that she's hugging him, and
she said it was okay.
She's checking him for injuries.
John, it was stupid of you to go there. God damn it! You have to be smarter than that. You almost got yourself killed.
It's like I just saved you.
Thinking. You cannot risk yourself even for me. Do you understand? You're too important. Do you understand? I had to get you out of that place. I'm sorry.
I didn't need your help. I can take care of myself.
What's wrong with your eyes?
Nothing.
I so strongly identify with John Connor in that scene because there's been any number of times in my life where I needed a hug and I got a lecture. That was my mom's version of a hug, right?
Yeah.
She was giving me a verbal hug. And to me it was, you're so stupid.
Yeah.
Why would you do that?
I'm gonna do something I normally don't do because everyone wants to do it.
Two thousand years later.
How did you get to a place where, is it just maturity? Is it just growing older? Is it being a parent yourself? How do you get to a place where you go from thinking she thinks I'm an idiot, she doesn't respect me, to what you say literally every time you talk about your mom with me is she did the best she could, which is such a compassionate place to be at. How do you get there?
Therapy. I'm serious. But it took until I started processing the emotional problems that I had and the issues that I was dealing with and recognizing that a lot of them had come from the hole that I had and the inadequacies that I felt. Not because my mom was a bad mom, but because she's, you know, a human. She didn't have all the answers. She didn't do it perfectly, which is why every time I get upset with my kids, I go put another $5 in their future therapy account.
Is that a real thing?
Oh, it is a real thing. Yeah. It's
actually a pretty awesome
a lot
idea.
Of money now. I'm doing the best I can. At some point between the age of 20 and 30, they're going to go, Dad, you screwed me up real bad. And I'm going to be like, here's your therapy money.
Uh-huh. Thanks. And then in their 30s, it's going to be, Dad, I love you. You did the best you could.
Right.
You know? And this is so crucial because I think a lot of people worry that they're screwing up their kids. And what I tell people is if you're worried that you're screwing up your kids, odds are you're probably not. Generally, the people who actually screw up their kids are the people who think that they're not and everything they do as a parent is fine, is great.
If they would just listen to me and do what I say, then everything would work perfectly. So,
right.
Well,
So one thing that I struggle with as a counselor is that I'm also a parent.
Yeah.
And so I'm here trying to teach people how to have healthy relationships. And I have, whenever I lose my temper at my kids, I have both personal and professional guilt,
it's
right?
Double,
or if
yeah.
my wife and I have an argument, it's like, I don't have the right to counsel anybody. My life's a mess. The worst ever is like if my wife and I have an argument on the phone and then I hang up and then I have to see a couple.
And you're like right into it. You're like,
and I'm
well.
Like, you should be kind to each other. But that's neither here nor there. The important thing is when you're a parent that you make it right. Because I don't know a single person who doesn't lose their temper at their kids, snap at their kids, do something that later they're like, oh, especially if you have multiple kids and the first one's kind of like the parenting guinea pig, you know, and you're like working the kinks out.
Sorry, Jack.
I don't think you're seriously messing up your kids because you're somebody who is self-aware enough to self-correct.
Have you met my kids?
You know, all growing up, I had this idea that Arnold was not a good actor.
Yeah.
And I was biased because of the accent and because of the muscles. Now, granted, he is not the greatest actor ever.
No, he's not Meryl Streep.
But he's way better than I thought he was
when
I was a kid.
He's really good.
If was the parents are dead.
And especially in these films, you'd think, well, it's easy. You'd be monotone and you'd be robotic.
So tough.
There's so much there as far as him observing and processing and calculating and trying to understand human behavior.
That's definitely you.
Speaking of popcorn, today we are celebrating Mother's Day and your birthday with
Lisa's
passion for popcorn. I've got coconut macadamia, which is the favorite flavor of the founding mother, Lisa herself.
And I have a birthday cake because it's my birthday and it's white chocolate and it's delicious. And it's got little jimmies in it.
Do me a favor, sound off in the comments, wish Alan a happy birthday. He deserves it.
Do I?
Want some of my fries?
So speaking of insecure attachment.
I don't think she's meaning to cold shoulder him there. I think she's just lost in her thoughts.
Yeah.
She's not trying to be rude to him.
No.
But look how used to it he is, just like you.
Yeah, he's just like, oh, okay, normal. I'll go talk to this Terminator.
Wish I could have met my real dad.
You will.
Yeah, I guess. I'm like 45, I think. I sent him back through time to 1984.
I mean, he's obviously looking for a father figure because he hasn't had that in his life.
But
he's really looking for both parents.
He's like, my dad hasn't been born yet, so I'm going to send him back in time.
Yeah.
Later.
Dead a bolt.
But yeah, he definitely is.
Mom and him are only together for one night. She still loves him, I guess. I see her crying sometimes. She denies it totally, of course, like she got something stuck in her eye.
Why do you cry?
You mean people?
Yeah.
I don't know.
To your point about
we just
Arnold
cry.
Mm-hmm. Being a really good performer in this.
He's like, why do you cry? And he goes, when it hurts.
You can also check us out on our socials at @therapy_cinema on Twitter and Instagram. We're on Facebook, and we're r/cinematherapy on Reddit.
And to all of you who are sharing us with your friends, thank you so, so much. You have no idea thank how you. Much it means to us. We are trying to reach as many people as we can, and we can't do it without you. This film had a profound effect on you as a filmmaker.
It absolutely did. So James Cameron is certainly one of my favorite filmmakers of all time, if not my actual favorite. This is the second R-rated film I ever saw. I guess cat's out of the bag. We can tell my parents now. I snuck to the movie theater when I was 11. One of the things about Terminator 2, like, the action sequences are, you know, rightfully regarded as some of the best of all time.
I swear I will not kill anyone.
What the hell are you doing?
He'll live.
James Cameron, very similar to Steven Spielberg, is obsessive about geography,
yeah.
which is extremely important when you're shooting an action sequence. You have to be able to understand where things are in relation to each other, what the impediments are.
The dangers and the risks.
The dangers and the risks. You set things up, you pay them off, like all of that stuff. And one of the things that I love about James Cameron is his filmmaking, it's not flashy.
How so?
You could describe it as workmanlike. Every shot, it gives you the information that you need without being overwhelming, and the cuts are completely invisible.
Yeah.
You never feel a James Cameron cut. Feels natural. Every shot tells you exactly what you need. It establishes relationships. It gives you emotional through lines. It's I love the man.
I mean, to me, there are a handful of perfect action films.
Yeah.
I look at this, I look at The Matrix, I look at Die Hard, I look at Raiders of the Lost Ark. What I would pick to round out the top five varies from day to day. But those are always...
Mad Max Fury Road.
Okay, there you go. But my favorite type of film is an action movie with substance.
Yes.
Right? Because it's not about the violence per se, it's about fighting for something.
Right.
And it's about the heroism of it, and it's about the... And there's... You might think a movie about a killer robot from the future that comes back in time sounds like kind of dumb sci-fi.
It's cheeseball sci-fi.
Like, at least in concept.
In concept,
the execution is so brilliant and intelligent, and what... blows my mind the most about a movie called Terminator 2 Judgment Day is just how much heart there is.
Yes.
I know so many people who said, I can't believe I cried in Terminator 2, but that movie...
Yeah, at the end of the movie, I cried when a robot died.
I know now why you cry.
The Terminator would never stop. It would never leave him. And it would never hurt him, never shout at him or get drunk and hit him or say it was too busy to spend time with him. It would always be there, and it would die to protect him.
The way I read this scene is, you know, she's...
All the would-be fathers who came and went over the years, this thing, this machine, was the only one who measured up.
She's talking about the would-be fathers.
In an insane world.
But I think she's also criticizing herself a little bit.
A robot's doing the job better than I am. But she's grateful that he's there.
Yeah. So here, Sarah Connor has figured out who is going to... invent the machines that will destroy humanity, and she's gone to kill him. And
hurt?
She couldn't do it.
Look at me. I almost.
Because the guy's got a family.
Yeah. The kids ran in and, like, begged her not to.
It'll be okay. Figure something out, okay?
And to his credit, he didn't mean to.
Promise.
Yeah, he was just working on processors. He wasn't
building
a defense network.
What did she say?
I did.
You came here to stop me?
Came here to stop me.
I love you, John. I always have.
He gets to...
Now it's my turn. I'm right here with you. This time it's crying with Alan and Jono.
What is wrong with your eyes?
This is intense.
this is kind of why I got into the field I got to. And it's the reason why I chose to become a family therapist specifically, as opposed to other fields of therapy, is to see people who are blocked get unblocked. Yeah. And to have moments like that, and then not just moments like that, but for it to shift the relationship itself.
Change their relationships.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that, I mean, that doesn't ring true with my experience. I didn't have to, like, parent my mother in the way that John is having
to. Although I'm sure a lot of people watching today can relate to that, like being the parent of your parent.
Yeah, this is not a thing that I had to do, but I'm sure that happens a lot. That moment of catharsis where she, you know, realizes what he's been doing and thanks him for being, you know, not just the protector of humanity, but her son.
Well, I love that she sees him that way. I think she's tried to not see him as her son, because if she gets too attached, then she can't do what needs to be done.
Yeah, he has to be General John Connor.
Right, and she's afraid she'll be soft, and then if she's soft, they're all dead. But I love that she says, you came to stop me, and then she says, I love you. I look at that, and for the first time, she is seeing him as the leader that he was always going to be.
Right.
And not somebody that she just has to take care of and rescue and protect and train.
As per usual in a James Cameron film, it ends in a spark factory.
But I love the lighting of this whole...
Oh, it's beautiful. It's really well done. James Cameron does the best Spark Factory.
John. John.
My reason for including this is...
Help me.
There's two of them?
Now there are two of them.
Get out of the way, John. Shoot!
Her biceps are as big as her heart.
Ooh. And the only reason I wanted to include that was because he has repaired his relationship with his mother enough that he can accept who and what she is, which is a badass shotgun-toting robot murderer. He can tell immediately which mom is the real mom, because he knows her so well and has accepted her.
Yeah.
That is the same thing that happened to me the one time that I got trapped in the spark factory.
How did you arrive at that place of acceptance of her? Maybe I'm assuming too broadly that you have arrived there as opposed to still working on it.
It's a lifelong process of dealing with my own issues and whatever. But I've arrived at a place where we're good. It's not always hugs and I love you, John.
Yeah.
But it's good.
And that's something that we're trying to do on the show, is destigmatize and normalize. Therapy is a beautiful, healthy thing.
I truly believe that literally everyone should go to therapy. We all have some kind of baggage, and it is better to deal with it and work with a professional who is trained in helping you deal with it than trying to shoulder it all by yourself, or than trying to put it on your friends, your family, your whoever, who may not be equipped. And who are dealing with their own crap.
Over a year ago, we had our very first video, which was Frodo and Radical Acceptance. And I see John and Alan arriving at this place. So Radical Acceptance is, there are things in your life that you can't control. So don't spend your time and energy on those things. Spend your time and energy on the things you have control over. And why we call it Radical Acceptance is, you don't have to like your situation to accept that it is your reality and make the most of it. You wanted a mother who was more of a nurturer.
Yeah.
You wanted a mother who was more accepting and who was more supportive, outwardly supportive. You didn't have that.
Right.
What you did have was a mom who cared about preparing you for the future, like Sarah Connor.
Yeah.
You had a mom who could be strict out of love, could be critical out of love. And while that wasn't what you wanted, it was your reality. And when you talk about we're good now, I see you saying, okay, this is my reality.
I've accepted it, yeah.
And I'm going to get these other needs met elsewhere. Mm-hmm. And I'm just going to love her.
Right. Yeah, and that's where we've arrived at. And my mom, you know, like Sarah Connor, is a total badass. She's not biceps and a shotgun badass like Sarah Connor.
She's an accomplished professor.
She was a business professor. She was a vice president of the university that we both attended after we were there. Business consultant. She's done so many incredible professional things. She's a wonderful grandmother. Well, I mean, she raised me, so she must have done a pretty good job.
Amen.
She is a badass.
Call to John now.
You. Until next week.
Come with me if you want to live.
We'll be back. And
watch movies.